Choice in games is a complete fabrication.
An illusion, but the question is, does that matter if the act of decision-making itself is fun? And as many of you have pointed out in the comments, no genre exemplifies this theory more than immersive sims. And in today's episode, we're going to be taking a look at the game design techniques that actually make this possible. So spoiler warning from this point onwards, guys, and welcome to the Anatomy of Immersive Sims and the Illusion of Choice Part 3. So, as we've seen in part 1 and 2 of this series, the outcomes of your choices in games ultimately don't matter. Because of this, the final piece of masking this from the player is to make the act of decision-making itself engaging. It's about the journey and not the destination, and no genre does this better than immersive sims. Commonly consisting of linear but open-ended level designs that allow its players to tackle its obstacles however they see fit. And to make this possible, they need to have an obscene amount of options ready for the player to use that 90% of them will never see. But the question is, how do you design levels like this to accommodate an immense amount of player choice without putting an insane amount of work and money into it? Well, the secret is, you don't. It's still going to cost at least a couple trucks worth of money, and we still have to use all of these tricks we've discussed in previous episodes to influence the player's actions. But immersive sims utilize the most simple manipulation to its fullest potential, by manipulating emotional decision making. An emotional decision is made very quickly in comparison to rational thought. It's reactive and largely subconscious, being used when confronted with immediate danger or in decisions of seemingly minimal significance. As designers, we can use this to our advantage, to make it feel as if those personal, emotional decisions have this huge impact, but when in reality, we're still in full control. For example, with the availability heuristic. The availability heuristic is a psychological effect where people pick what is most familiar to them. And this can be based on emotional cues, familiar facts, or vivid imagery that leave an easily recalled impression in our minds. And because of this, these are impulsive decisions. Weirdly enough, the availability heuristic can be seen in development itself. Have you ever wondered why we keep seeing a lot of the same designs over and over again? It's food for thought. Now, how can we use this psychological effect as designers? Well, because of the inherent linear nature of games, there are only a set number of things a player could possibly do, even in a sprawling open world game where we're using cross divergences. So we need to guide the player to that gameplay in the most natural way possible so it feels organic to them. And the key aspect to this is making it very, very clear what type of gameplay the player will see if they choose a specific option. Even if the player eventually has to do all of these things in order to progress the game, if we communicate a level's intent through dialogue or level design, the player will instinctively gravitate towards a singular preferred option based on the availability heuristic, which leads to gameplay that they personally enjoy. This is incredibly simple, right? But the player will now view that simple option as their own thought-out process, giving the entire journey more meaning, which is sick because it does 90% of the work for us in their brains. But regardless of how much we do this, the player still has control over one thing that scares me as a designer: movement. But you know what? Fuck you, players. Even the simplest thing you could possibly hope to have autonomy over is still heavily manipulated. Because even in open world or sandbox games that seemingly have an insane amount of freedom, we're still subtly guiding the player to the paths with the most worthwhile content. By abusing favored availability heuristics using the isolation effect.
Big word! Big word!
The isolation effect, also known as the von Restoff effect, is when someone is presented with multiple options, but one noticeably differs from the others, this specific option is more likely to be considered. In games, this can be seen in initially highlighted text boxes, and the use of diegetic lighting to guide the player's eye, subtle movement of animals, the geometry of the environment itself, haptic feedback in the controller at key moments, or people painting the bloody fucking walls, these contrasting sights and sounds in the scene make it more likely for the player to consider these options, which then leads to the most interesting gameplay and narrative progressions, making the player feel as if their spur of the moment emotional decision making led them to this amazing discovery when it really didn't. Immersive sims and open world games need to do this to succeed, or the player will aimlessly wander around and get overwhelmed by the paradox of choice. But the real trick with immersive sims and why they're so bloody expensive to make is that even if you don't notice these subtle hints, each and every path you could possibly take will lead you to your goal. With immersive sims, more than any other genre, it's about the journey and not the destination. Objectives being steal a thing, kill a dude, or I don't know, skank in a specific spot, they're not really that interesting, but it's how you get there that's important. It's what happens along these paths that we need to pay attention to, and how we keep the player moving and engage, demanding their attention through mystery, combat and stealth, but nothing more than difficulty. The difficulty of a game drives the player to make more emotional decisions in the moment. The need for stealth, forced combat, evading and running away from guards, and navigating as fast as you can to the closest and most obvious route of escape. We can induce all of these to cause panic, which then in turn makes the isolation effect even stronger. And this is also where we reward the player for this emotional decision making to reinforce it even further. With ever decreasing health and resources, this encourages the player to pay close attention to their environment and forces further exploration, looking for ways to overcome their challenges, leading to the discovery of extrinsic rewards, be it health, currency, items, or information, making these emotional decisions have even more impact as the player feels as if they only succeeded due to this discovery. Now, the question is all of this a good or a bad thing for the player? And the answer is yes. The real question is, does it even matter? Does having choice in games matter at all, or is the illusion of choice enough? Feeling as if your actions have consequences even if they don't. As designers, it's our jobs to make the player feel as if they have freedom and autonomy, while also crafting an engaging and memorable experience within the confines we have. Now, the answer to this question is going to be largely driven by your input as players, as I am incredibly biased, it's not even funny. So let me know down below, because I would love to discuss this with you. Right, so this episode caps off my basic introduction to the illusion of choice in video games, and one of the things I've regretted with this three-part series is that I've not been able to go into enough detail with examples because I've had so much theory I've needed to convey, and writing these episodes is very different from writing one of my lectures. But in my next two episodes, I want to do some in-depth breakdowns, and I would like you to suggest two things in the comments for me. One is the best example of choice in games you have ever seen, and the worst. And from these suggestions, I will pick the two best examples and make breakdowns on them. So choose wisely. Thank you so much for watching, guys. I really hope you enjoyed today's episode. And I just want to say a big thank you to Escapist and my wonderful patrons for actually making this possible. And if you too do enjoy this series and you want to see more, I actually have my own channel with lots of similar content over there. And I can't wait to see you over there as well as on here on The Escapist. Thank you so much for the support, mate. I'll see you in the next one. Yeah.